Hi, young Palawans. It's May the 4th. May the 4th be with you. I'm Katie Gervin. I'm calling you from the Tulsa Zoo, joining you from the Tulsa Zoo. And we've got a really exciting program for you today. We're going to learn all about some animal adaptations that we can find in the Star Wars universe. Pretty cool. Are you ready? All right, let's get started. But before we get into our planets of the Star Wars universe, we kind of have to learn about what an adaptation is, right? Does anybody know out there? What is an adaptation? Well, an adaptation is something that the animal has or something an animal does that helps them survive better in the wild. For example, right here, this big funny bone, this is from a giraffe neck. And as you know, giraffes' necks are huge, very long, long necks. And that's a special adaptation that giraffes have to help them eat the leaves at the very, very tops of the trees. Now, the other animals in the savanna don't have that adaptation, right? So they have an advantage or an edge over those other animals, right? They can get those leaves at the top and the other animals can't, right? Pretty cool bone, right? The giraffe has 7 of these in their neck, and they actually have the same amount as most mammals, right? So people being mammals, we have vertebrae in our neck as well, and we have 7. But a giraffe's neck bones, or vertebrae, are much, much larger, right? Big as my head, right? Awesome. Now, another adaptation that some animals have, this is an owl skull. Check that out, an owl skull. And if you notice, you can see those huge holes right here, and that's where their eyes would go. Now, remember, owls are active at night or nocturnal, okay? So they are going to have those huge eyes so they collect a lot of light at night so they can see better, okay? Pretty cool. Now also, they see really well. They'll be able to see a mouse about a football field away. So pretty amazing skill that they have. But since their eyes are so large, they actually don't have the muscles to be able to move their eyes. And that's where you hear about owls being able to turn their heads so well, okay? So let's do a little experiment. If you guys can all look forward for me, look forward, all right? And without moving your head, try to look over in that direction. You can do it, right? All right, now try the other direction. Yeah, you can do that, right? Well, owls can't do that, and that's why they have to move their heads. So their eyes are stationary, stuck in their heads, so they would have to turn their heads, okay? And a lot of people believe they can turn their heads 360 degrees around, and they can't actually turn it that far, but they can see that far around. So they can turn their heads all the way around and maybe face that direction, about 270. But they have range of vision about 360 degrees all the way around their heads. Pretty cool. So let's go ahead and dive in to those Star Wars planets, okay? And our first planet everybody's familiar with is Hoth. Check that out. Now this, of course, is the location of Echo Base, one of the Rebel bases. And Echo Base is really set in a harsh climate, so they could stay hidden. Now Hoth, the planet Hoth, is super, super cold, right? Very, very cold, very icy planet. There's another picture of that. Not lots around. Now, does anybody remember any animals that lived on Hoth? Right, you saw one in those pictures. We have the Tauntaun, right? The Tauntaun lives on Hoth. Now, the Tauntaun does have some pretty amazing adaptations to be able to survive there, right? Check out these feet. These feet are huge, all right? And big feet allow this animal not to sink down into the snow and just stay on the surface so they can stay there. Did you know that these Tauntauns, they can run 90 kilometers per hour? Wow, that's really, really, really fast. And I guess that's why Luke Skywalker and Han Solo used to ride them, right? Those rebels used to use them as transportation, right? Now, another adaptation that these guys have, if you can see it, they actually have four nostrils, and that's to help keep their temperature. If they are running really hard and need a lot of air, they can use those four nostrils to breathe. But if it's a little bit colder out, they can shut those nostrils and just use one set so they don't release as much heat. All right? Now, one thing that I'm missing, what is this guy covered in? He's covered in fur, of course, and that helps him stay warm in the cold, hot environment. Now, this guy has to watch out for somebody else. The Wampus, one of my favorite characters here, right? The Wampus, of course, caught a Tauntaun that Luke Skywalker was riding, my brother, right? So, the Wampus has huge claws so they can catch those Tauntauns. They also have really sharp teeth so they can grab hold of their prey and eat them down, right? And again, they're covered with thick white fur. Now, of course, that white fur does keep them warm, but it also helps as camouflage, okay? Now, a couple of animals that we have here on Earth that have some of the same adaptations as animals on Hoth, because remember, we have some very cold environments here on Earth as well. We call them tundras or high up in the mountains. Some animals here have some of those same adaptations. Like this animal right here. This is from a snow leopard, right? And you can see this warm, thick fur that they have to keep them warm in the cold mountains of Nepal, okay? Now also check out that pattern that they have. This pattern makes them virtually invisible in their natural environment. They blend in really well, and that is really helpful when you're trying to stalk your prey, right? You're completely hidden, your prey doesn't know you're coming. Another animal we have are snowy owls. And this is a foot from a snowy owl. And snowy owls, a lot of owls out there do not have feathers that cover their feet. However, a snowy owl does. And that's so their feet stay nice and warm in the brutal cold environment that they live in. And one last one that lives in the tundra here. Of course, there's lots of animals, but an example that I have this guy. Can anybody guess what this might be? This one reminds me of the Wampa. This is from a polar bear, right? Polar bears have huge teeth, and that gives them the ability to eat lots and lots of different animals that live in the Arctic, right? So they can eat whales and all sorts of things that live up there. They can actually pull whales right out of the water. Now, they do have that very streamlined head, very sleek. That's hydrodynamic, so they can swim through the water and get around up there in the tundra. Pretty cool. Now we do have a special guest coming on to visit us. Miss Claire is going to bring us a friend from Earth.
Hello, fellow Earthlings. So I have here a familiar looking creature. This is a chinchilla. So right here, this is Harley Chin, the chinchilla, and you might recognize this chinchilla shares a lot of the same adaptations as some of our other earthly creatures and also some of the aliens we talked about. So taking a look at Harley, do you notice something about her? Maybe how big, fluffy, and round she is? So she shares the same adaptation as maybe those Tauntauns and the Wampa and our snow leopards. She is covered in dense fur. So what's incredible about this dense fur is that for each hair follicle, she can have up to 20 hairs in each hair follicle. That's a lot of hair. And another adaptation with that hair, let's say a predator's coming after Harley, oh no! What's she gonna do? She can actually drop her hair. So have you ever had your cat's hair in your mouth or your own hair? You know it's very uncomfortable. So a predator would go like, oh no, I don't wanna eat that. Harley here can be found up in the Andes Mountains in South America. So that's why she needs this dense fur. She also has something really cool with her feet similar to the Tauntaun. Not sure if you can see him, but she has long, flat feet, perfect for jumping and doing some awesome parkour trips up in the mountainous area. So that is Harley Chin, our chinchilla from Earth, and I think we're going to move on to another planet here. So, Princess Katie, would you like to come back?
Hello.
All right, so that was a really cool animal. Remember, Hoth is super cold, unforgiving, icy planet. We also have those environments here on Earth, right? Like the tundra or up in the Andes Mountains, it's very cold. But our next planet is vastly different. Still very harsh environment, but still very different from our last one. And of course, you might have already guessed it, it is Tatooine. Tatooine is, of course, the birthplace or home planet of both Anakin Skywalker and Luke Skywalker, right? But you can see it is a very desolate environment. Super, super, super hot and super, super, super dry. And one of the reasons it is so hot there is because they do actually have two suns. Oh my goodness. Two suns make it very, very hot. Now the animals that live in on Tatooine do have to be adapted to that desert environment. And one of the most scariest animals out there, of course, is the Sarlacc. All right, now the Sarlacc, we can just see on the surface of the sand is his mouth, all right? But under the sand lies something far larger. So if we look at a cross section, this is the Sarlacc. He buries himself in the sand and his body remains underground with just his mouth hanging out so he can eat things.
Mmm, yum.
Another animal from Tatooine is the Dewback. All right. Now, of course, you might have seen some stormtroopers riding the Dewback as they are domesticated, but the Dewback are completely adapted to their Tatooine environment. They do have that thick, scaly skin, which helps retain moisture so they don't lose it. Remember, water is very valuable in a desert situation. All right. They also have those large mouths so they can chomp down bushes all at once, all one bite, because they are herbivores where they only eat plant material. Okay? And there's not a lot of opportunity to eat plants in a desert. So when the opportunity is there, they have to eat it quickly so others can't find it. Okay? Now, of course, we do have desert environments here on Earth, and a lot of animals have adaptations to help them survive here, okay? Now, one of those animals is this guy, okay? This is a girdle lizard, and you can see that this animal is covered with spiny scales, and those spiny scales, of course, help protect them, okay? But they also help retain that moisture that they would lose from the desert sun, okay? Now, this is a really cool animal because not only does it have that scaly skin, but when it gets scared or threatened, it would actually bite the end of its tail and form a little ball, kind of like an armadillo, and they are known as armadillo girdle lizards. Pretty cool. Now, this guy right here uses a bit of the same strategy as the Sarlacc. So in the daytime, all right, these guys are going to bury themselves, just like that Sarlacc. A lot of animals in the desert do like to go underground during the hot of the day. It's very, very hot, so they like to get away from that sun. But at nighttime, they will come out of their underground layers. Okay, scorpion. All right. Another animal that is all very famous for living in the desert are rattlesnakes. And again, rattlesnakes have this thick, scaly skin to help retain that moisture and they won't lose it, okay? Reptiles do really well in desert environments because they get their energy, a lot of energy, from the sun, okay? And they love to get hot and warm. All right, let's go ahead and meet another friend from a desert environment.
Hello again. So I have a tiny reptile here. This is Glitter the Chuckwalla. So these guys are actually quite unique. You can find them in the southwestern part of the United States and even down a little bit southern in Mexico and parts of Central America. So these guys have a funny name, Chuckwalla, But they also have a couple of those fun adaptations we talked about in our alien species and our other earthly creatures. So, like Princess Katie was talking about, dewback and our rattlesnakes and all our other scaly creatures, they have scales, which are perfect for making sure that the moisture doesn't get out. This guy doesn't drink a lot of water because of where he lives. He's going to be found in the desert. These guys also pretty much are only herbivores. They eat just flowers, fruit, cactuses, anything that might have a little bit of moisture in them. And what's also really fun about this little creature is you might be able to tell he's a little puffy right now. We talked about the girdle lizard and how they had some fun adaptations. So Glitter's not gonna curl up in a ball. Glitter's gonna do a little something different. All chuckawallas, if they feel threatened, they're gonna do one of the funniest adaptations I've ever seen. They're gonna take a big deep breath and they're going to puff up. Glitter's puffing up just a little bit. He's not that worried right now, but he could puff up 3 times his size. Can you believe that? So if a predator is chasing after him, this little guy can run in between the cracks of some rocks, inflate, and then the predator can't get to him. There's not enough room to get him out. Another cool thing is a lot of people like to call these guys cold-blooded. So it means that doesn't mean that they have cold blood. Instead, it means that these guys are going to be the same temperature as it is outside. So their inside body heat is dependent on the weather outside. So today, our Glitter would probably have a great time with the hot day we're gonna have today. So that was Glitter, our chuckawalla from Earth.
All right, guys, now we need you to help us out a little bit. What we want for you to do is gather your art supplies, all right? So you could have crayons, or Play-Doh, or googly eyes, construction paper, tissue paper, whatever craft supplies you have lying around. If you don't have any craft supplies, that's okay too. Just have a sheet of paper, just blank paper, and a pencil. You can do the same thing for our activity. What we want you to do, we are looking for some new creatures for our Star Wars universe, and we want you to create them. Now, think about those planets that we were talking about earlier. So we talked about Hoth, and we talked about Tatooine. Now you need to design an animal that will fit on one of those planets, okay? Make sure that those animals have the adaptations that they need to survive on those planets, because you wouldn't want to put an animal with huge thick fur on a hot environment, right? Because they wouldn't do very well, right? We want to have good adaptations so that animal can survive and thrive in that environment, okay? All right, and we are going to have some examples by our starfighter, Claire.
So I had a lot of fun creating some new aliens. First, I'm gonna show you my favorite one. This right here is what I like to call a floof-fluff-fluff. So I imagine this creature would probably be the best suited to be in Hoth. You might be able to tell some of the adaptations that we talked about. Look at how big and fluffy it is. He's not gonna have to worry about being cold out in that tundra. You can also take a look at his big feet. He is probably gonna be doing a great job running around on that ice and snow because he has a lot of weight distribution. And lastly, you can take a look, he's probably not gonna be a predator. Look at his tiny arms. He's not gonna be able to hunt. He is going to be grazing on grasses and maybe some other Arctic vegetation. And then right here, this guy is also my favorite. I wanna call him a slump. I think he'd be aquatic. What's that one planet called?
Dagobah.
Dagobah. So this would be a Dagobah or maybe a swampy place.
Dagobah.
Dagobah. I really like Dagobah. And so he has some gills, he has some big eyeballs, and he got some fun frills on top. And last but not least, I decided to craft something out of Play-Doh. This guy right here, this guy's really fun. I'm gonna put him really close. So he is brightly colored. I think this guy would probably do a good job of living on Tatooine because he is scaly. I tried my best to put some cool scales on him. He also has a snake-like serpent tail. A lot of snakes live in the desert, so I thought he probably would do a pretty good job. And then last but not least, I gave him some sand. So he's probably going to be eating some really tasty prey. So those are my little creations. I didn't tell you the name for this guy. I think I'm going to name him, I think it was Zookzo? Can't remember. But I like the name of that guy too.
All right, Miss Claire, are you ready for a challenge?
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to give her a challenge and have her make one of our animals right here with us today, okay? And I'm going to say that she has to make an animal for the planet of Naboo, right? The planet of Naboo is where my mother comes from, all right? And Naboo is a beautiful, temperate, beautiful weather planet. Great, not too hot, not too cold, perfect weather. It also is covered with vast oceans, all right? Jar Jar Binks loves to swim down in the oceans where his village is, and these oceans are huge. The oceans are filled with terribly huge, scary sea creatures, right? So very large predators, right? So I'm gonna challenge Miss Claire to go ahead and design one of those animals right here.
So because this planet is made mostly of water, I think I'm going to make an aquatic type of animal. And I thought, what better way for an animal to have a really cool adaptation than to be the same color as water? So we're gonna work with blue Play-Doh. And Princess Katie mentioned that there's probably a lot of predators out on this island, so I think I'm gonna make a huge aquatic predator. I'm gonna make him have a really big mouth. Rawr! And let's see, so it's aquatic, so do you think it's gonna have arms or fins? I think fins would work better. But I'm out of blue, so let's see. I think I'm going to use some white, because there's also some maybe white colors. Sharks sometimes have white underbellies. So when prey looks up, they see white that kind of matches the sky from underneath. So I'm gonna give him a white underbelly too. He's looking pretty good. And let's see. I think I'm also gonna give him a big fin on top. And then last but not least, this guy has to see, right? I think I'm gonna use googly eyes and put some big googly eyes on this fellow. Oh, I love this guy. So he's probably gonna be kind of similar to a serpent. He doesn't have big fins on the side of him, but he's gonna be good at just gobbling up small creatures. Yes. Wow. You got a name for this guy? What do you think?
Big Mouth McGee.
Big Mouth McGee, what a good name for an alien. Well, I think that's probably the best we're gonna do.
Awesome, good job, Miss Claire. You did great on making that animal. Now, she did really good job without knowing any of the adaptations of the animals that you could find on that planet, right? She used her brain and thought, what would make a good adaptation if you're living on that planet? So she made that large mouth. She has those fins on there. She did a really good job. Now, some other animals, like animals that live here on Earth that would live in that type of environment, would be maybe an alligator. Right? All right? And this is some alligator skin. Now, alligators, like on Naboo, there's some dangerous predators around, right? And even though an alligator is a predator and does hunt, they still have to protect themselves. So they do have this very thick armor, okay? They actually have bones underneath their skin that act as armor, and those are called osteoderms. Pretty cool, all right? Another really cool adaptation that some animals have that live in a water type environment are these type of feet. Check that out. These are web feet. Obviously, these are used like paddles to paddle their way through the water. But another way that these feet can be useful is if they're walking on mud. Have you guys ever walked on mud before? Think about it. What happens? You sink right down into the mud and you get kind of stuck, right? So these web feet will help them stay on the surface of the water. Another really cool thing, check this out. This is from a great blue heron. We have these around here in Oklahoma. Great blue heron. And check out this beak. This beak is specially adapted for them to do what? If you said hunt, you got it right. So they catch their prey with this sharp beak. Okay, pretty cool. So they use it, stab that fish, and then they can eat it. All right, well, we've had a lot of fun with you today going over adaptations. We love this. We love Star Wars, so we wanted to bring that to you. May the 4th be with you. Remember, my name is Katie, and I'm one of the education managers here at the Tulsa Zoo. I had Claire with me today. Claire is one of our education specialists, and we really enjoyed speaking with you today. And may the 4th be with you.
Good morning, Oklahoma students. My name is Carly, and today we are going to practice some reading skills that can help us all become great readers. So if you have something to write with, a pencil or a marker or a crayon and a piece of paper, I want you to go ahead and grab those things now. I'm so excited to get to work with you today. We're going to work on a new letter sound. and we will practice writing and spelling and reading some words with that new letter sound. While some of our friends are still grabbing their writing tool and their paper, let's talk about the calendar and about the weather. Let's do the calendar first. I have some new words on our board, so let's take a look at those.
Today, yesterday, and tomorrow. Today, what is today? Does anybody know?
That's right, today is Monday. Monday, May 4th. And what is the year? Can anyone tell me the year? That's right, the year is 2020. So today is Monday, May 4th, 2020. If you already have your paper and your writing tool, you can write Monday, May 4th with me.
Monday, M-O-N-D-A-Y. Monday.
How do we spell May?
M-A-Y. Monday, May 4th.
That is today. So if today is Monday, May 4th, what was yesterday? What was the day of the week? And what was the date? That's right, yesterday was Sunday. What about the date? Was it, if today is May 4th, then yesterday must have been May 3rd, right? So yesterday was Sunday.
Sunday.
S-U-N-D-A-Y.
Sunday, May 3rd.
So if yesterday was Sunday, May 3rd, and today is Monday, May 4th, what will tomorrow be? Right, tomorrow will be Tuesday. And what will the date be? It'll be Tuesday, May 5th. Tuesday, May 5th. So let's spell Tuesday. T-U-E-S-D-A-Y. Tuesday. T-U-E-S-D-A-Y.
May.
Fifth. Great job. We learned how to spell some new words, too. We learned how to spell Sunday and Tuesday. Okay. What about the weather? If you're near a window or a door, you can hop up and go to one. Let's look outside. I'm right by my door. What do you think? Is it sunny? Is it cloudy? It's a little bit of both, right? It's a little bit cloudy today. Do you think it will be warm today or will it be chilly today? I think it will be warm too. Okay, now we're ready to work on breaking up some new words. So this is called segmenting, or you could call it breaking up the word. And I am going to say a word, and you will say the sounds in the word, and you'll count the sounds while you do it. So let's do one together. And watch as I use my fingers to count the sounds that I make. So our first word, we'll do this one together, will be fish. Fish. So we're going to make the sounds in the word fish, and every time we make a new sound, we'll hold up a finger. That way we can keep track. Ready? Fish. 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 Let's do it again together one more time. Fish. I-sh. Fish. And there were three sounds in fish. Great job breaking up fish, everyone. Let's try the word me. Me. What's the first sound you hear in me? Mmm, that's right. So, mmm, and what's the second sound? E, me, mmm, e. Great work. What about the word light? Light. Great, let's do it together now. O-I-T. Three sounds. Good. Let's try the word O. O, like, oh no, I dropped my pencil. O. O. O only has one sound. Okay. All of the other words will have more than one sound. Let's do the word it. It. Great, we'll do it together now. It. It. Two sounds. Let's do the word hat. Is anybody wearing a hat on their head today? I'm not. Hat. Good. Let's do it together this time. At. Hat. Three sounds in the word hat. Let's do the word man. Man. Great job. Let's do it together. Mmm. Ah. Mmm, mmm, ah, mmm. Three sounds in the word man. Let's break up one more word together. Let's do the word sigh. That was a sigh. Great, let's do it together. S-I. I. Only two sounds in the word sigh. Great work segmenting, everyone. Now that we broke up the sounds in each word, I am going to say sounds and you will blend them together and tell me the whole word. So let's practice one together. If I were to make the sounds s, a, n, what word am I saying if we blend those sounds together? Listen carefully. S-a-n. That's right. The word is sun. Very good. Let's try another one. M-oo-n. M-oo-n. If we blend those sounds together, the word is moon. That's right. What if I said the sounds a p, a p? Ape is the word I said. That's right. An ape, if you're wondering, is a kind of monkey. Okay. Let's try this one. Mm, ah, mm. Mm, ah, mm. That's right. The word I said was mom. Good job blending that together. Let's try these sounds. F, ah, g. F, ah, g. That's right. The word was fog. Great job. I know that F sound is a little hard to hear. Fog. Good job. Let's blend one more word. N-et. N-et. And that word was net. That's right. Great job blending, everyone. Okay, let's move on to our new sound. Today's sound is long O. It's like the sound that we make when we are surprised or when we just remembered something, like, oh, I dropped my pencil. That was the example I used earlier today. Or, oh, now I remember where I left my favorite book. So let's practice saying the long O sound together. First, we'll say it short, and then we'll stretch it out, okay? O. Good. O. One more time. Really stretch it out this time. O. Great job, everyone. Okay. Now, I want you to listen and repeat after me, and we're going to practice saying some words that have the long O sound at the beginning of the word. So, the first word is open. Say open. The next word is oak. Oak is a type of tree. Say oak. Good. Only. Say only. Good. Let's try own. Say own. Great. Let's try one more at the beginning. Ocean. Say ocean. Great job. Did you hear and feel what it was like to say the long O sound at the beginning of those words? Good. Now we will practice, listen and repeat after me, words with the long O sound in the middle of the word. So let's start with the word bone. Say bone. Let's do the word road. Say road. Boat. Say boat. Goat. Say goat. And finally, we have the word tone. And tone is a word to describe sound. Tone. Say tone. Great job, everyone. Did you hear the long O sound? And did you feel what it was like to say the long O sound in the middle of those words? Good. Can you tell me if long O is a vowel sound or a consonant sound? That's right. It is a vowel sound because we say it with an open mouth. And I notice that every time we say a word with a long O sound, our mouths kind of make an O shape, right? Like in the word open or in the word road. Do you feel that too? Great. So now I'm going to say some words. And some of the words will have long O as the middle sound, and some of them will not. So I want you to listen very carefully. And if you want, you can close your eyes to help you concentrate. And I want you to raise your hand when you hear a word that has the long O sound. Okay? So let's try. The first word is going to be rose. My mom has a rose bush in the front yard. Rose. Good. Rose has the long O in the middle of it. What about the word Take. I think I will take my dog on a walk today. Take. Did take have a long O sound? No, that's right. It did not. The next word is soap. Make sure you use soap to wash your hands. Soap. Did soap have a long O sound? Yes, it did. Boot. You might need a pair of boots if it's snowy where you live. Boot. Did boot have a long O sound? No, it does not. Let's try the word note. Note. I think I will write a note to my mom for Mother's Day. Note. Good. Note had a long O sound in the middle. What about the word home? Home. That's right. Home has a long O in the middle. What about the word lock? You should lock your car door when you get out of it. Lock. Does lock have a long O sound in it? That's right. There's no long O sound in the word lock. How about the word goat? Sometimes at the petting zoo, they have a goat. Does goat have a long O sound in it? Yes, it does. Good job, everyone. What about the word foot? Foot. Does foot have a long O sound in it? No, it doesn't. Good job. Let's try the word phone. Phone. Does phone have a long O sound in it? Yes, it does. Let's try the word block. I might take a walk around the block later. Block. Does block have a long O sound in it? Nope, it does not. Okay, last word. The word is show. Show. I would like to show my mom my spelling words later today. Show. Does show have a long O sound? Yes, it does. Great job, everyone. Now we are going to practice writing the long O sound. If you have your writing tool and your paper, now's a great time to pick that up. If you don't have anything to write with, that is okay. You are just going to practice writing in the air so you can see the shape of the letters in your mind. Okay, so the spelling for the long O sound is very similar to the spellings that we have learned for the long A and the long I sound. So let's write it on the board. I'm going to write O. And then I'm going to draw a line because I need a blank space here. And then there will be an E. O and E work as a team in a word to make the long O sound. O. If we were writing an actual word, we would have a letter in the blank and maybe one in front too. So let's see if we can come up with a word. Let's do the word rode. One time at a birthday party, I rode a pony. Rode. So let's use another color. I put an R in front of the O, and in our blank spot here, I'm going to write a D. Road.
and the E and the O work together, and E makes O say long O. If we didn't know about the rule that E makes O say long O, that it makes O say its name, we might sound this word out and say odd. But because we just learned that E will make O say its name, O, this word is road. Great job, everyone. Okay, I want you to practice writing the word either in the air or on your paper and say the sounds. And I'm going to write it again too. Road. Road. O-D. What do we need at the end? That's right, we need an E. And we're going to try one more word like this, and the word is going to be note. Note. N-O-T. And at the end, we need an E. Great job, everyone. Okay. We had so much fun learning and growing today, and we have one more quick activity before we go. And we're going to practice spelling some more words with the long O sound. And at the end, we'll check our work. So we have five spelling words. Are you ready? Your first spelling word is poke. It's not very nice to poke your friends. Poke. Good. Are you ready for the next word? The next word is home. When I get home from school, sometimes I take a nap. Home. Ready? The next word is joke. It can be fun to tell knock-knock jokes. You know what? We only have four words. So here's our final word for today. It is tote. Tote. Tote is a word that we use if you have to carry something heavy around, like your backpack. Somebody might say, "You tote all those books around all day long." Tote. Okay, let's check our work before we go. The first word was poke, P-O-K-E, poke. The next word was home, H-O-M-E, home. Then we did the word joke, J-O-K-E, joke. And our fourth and final word was tote, T-O-T-E, tote. Did anybody get all four words right? How about just three words? Great job, everyone. That's definitely a tricky spelling. Okay, it is almost time for us to be done for today. I am so proud of the work you did. Next week, we're going to learn another new letter sound. We'll add it to our bank of letter sounds. Remember, we have long A, long I, and long O now. So make sure you come back again next Monday, and we will learn how to read and spell more new words. Thank you so much, everyone.
Hello and welcome. My name is Miss Rainbow, and I'm a teaching artist with AHA Tulsa. Normally, I might visit your school today and do this lesson, but since we're trying to stay healthy and keep others healthy, we're going to be creative virtually. Today, we'll be doing my Be Friendly art class, which I like to do to kind of get you to where you're not so afraid of bees and you want to look at them as friends. And so what we'll need today to do this project is you can just do basic paper, lined paper if you have some, regular paper, a pencil, and a marker of some sort, black preferably. And for if you want to color it in the future too, you can do markers, colored pencils, things of that nature. So, first I want to talk about the importance of the bees. The bees are here because we need them to pollinate everything. And if we didn't have the bees, there would be no fruit and flowers. And so we really need the bees to be working. That's their favorite thing, is to work. And so when we talk about pollination, bees cross-pollinate, and they go from flower to flower. And as they're going to flower to flower, they are getting nectar from each flower that they are getting with their tongue, and they're taking that nectar and they are storing it in their honey stomach. And they have a separate stomach for their food, but that's the where they're storing that nectar. And once it's full, they will go back to the hive. And so while they're doing that, though, they are going from flower to flower, from plant to plant, and they're taking, they've got these little bristle things on them, they're taking the pollen and they're spreading it to other plants, and it really helps it grow. And so farmers like to have a beehive by, or a bee box. A lot of them may have a box by their garden. So if you have a garden A and it has a beehive by it, and then you have garden B and it doesn't have a beehive by it, garden A's garden is going to be so much better than garden B's garden. And so we want to make sure that they're staying here so those farmers can grow the food too. So, next I'm going to talk about the beehive. And in doing that, I am going to switch around here because I'm going to do some drawing, so bear with me for a minute. And the beehive consists of a lot of what's called hexagons. And inside each hexagon, this hexagon has several different purposes. First, it stores the honey. But it also is where the queen lays her eggs, which is called larvae. And they grow inside the hexagon. So the hive is made up of all kinds of hexagons. And a hive can kind of look, you know, have different forms like this. And it likes to hang from a tree or some kind of heavy, heavy thing that can hold it. Or it can come in a box like you see on a farm. And then they just kind of have a little entryway that they go into. And that's how a lot of beekeepers and farmers have their beehives. And that's totally workable as well. But generally, the beehive is off in a distance. And I'll tell you who likes to get that beehive is if it's around is a bear. The bear is the biggest, probably the biggest, biggest predator next to humans with the bees or wanting their honey. And so they go, the larvae, which is the queen's job, is to lay the eggs in the hexagons. Pretty much that's her main job, is to just lay eggs. Lay eggs and lay eggs, and as long as she's productive, she can stay queen. And so while they're in the larvae, there are three types of bees, too. There's the queen bee. There's the worker bee. And there's the nursing bees. And by nursing, they take care of the hive. They take care of the larvae, and they take care of the queen. So the nursing bees stay in the hive. The worker bees go out to get the nectar and pollen and cross and do their pollen job of pollination. And the queen bee, her main job is just to lay eggs. Okay? Got that. So when the bees go out, they go get the pollen. But right now, let me see here. Right now, the bees are kind of facing a lot of dangers with what's going on. And if they go out and they try to find some flowers and they can't find any, it's not going to be good for the bees. And we are doing stuff like we're spraying herbicide. And herbicide is a plant. It kills plants. And a lot of times we want to use it for the weeds. And a lot of times those weeds produce the dandelion, which are those pretty yellow flowers that grow. But they're also considered a weed, but they're also the first food for the bees. So if you see any yellow dandelions, I would leave them alone because we want them for the bees to eat. Also, the clover is really good. They produce the three-leaf clovers, four-leaf clovers if you're looking. And they have the white flowers that the bees really love. So I don't mow my yard for a while because I like for this to get nice and big for the bees to eat off of. So the herbicides is kind of one of the dangers the bees have right now. And then there's also pesticide, which a pesticide kills pests pretty much. And the pest would actually kill the bee, the larvae, if they spray it on a hive or something, and most likely the queen bee. So those pesticides, we really, really don't like them because it would kill all of them. So next, we are going to... we're going to talk about the queen real quick. The queen bee, or how the queen bee is chosen. So the nursing bees decide who's going to be the next queen. And most of the time they decide this because the queen bee is not producing the amount of eggs she should be producing. And so in doing that, the nursing bees say, well, the queen, we need a new queen. And all the bees, while they're in that hexagon, get fed what's called royal jelly. And royal jelly gets fed to a worker bee for 3 days. That's it. Then they seal this up with wax, and the worker bee's gonna turn into a bee while it's in there. But the queen bee, she gets fed royal jelly the whole time. So In doing so and being fed the royal jelly, she becomes an adult bee. She's the only one that's really considered an adult bee in the hive. The worker bees are not considered adult bees. That's why if they sting you, they can sting you, and with that sting, they are they die. But a queen bee can sting you, and she won't die because she is considered an adult bee. So that's how they decide who gets to be the queen. And sadly, the old queen, she gets kicked out of the hive if she's not producing anymore. So they've got work to do, and if you're not working, you got to go. So now we are going to, if you'll get your paper and pencil, we are going to create our own bee, a honeybee. Let me make sure this is, can you guys see that? All right. I just want to check real quick. I created one on my shirt of what we're going to do. And you can see I kind of did a fun little rainbow in the middle there. We're going to do the eyes and the abdomen. This middle here is called the thorax. But that's what we are going to do is we are going to now create a bee. I draw out a bee. All right. So first, you want to kind of get it right in the middle here. Oh, whoops. I was actually going to do it with a paper, blank paper. So first, you want to start out with the middle. Sorry, I'm new. I'm trying to make sure that this... Let me adjust this. You're going to do the middle there. And that middle part is called the thorax. I want y'all to write that out right here. It's called a thorax, the middle part. And then you want to come down here and almost kind of draw out a ice cream cone style thing, which is going to be called the abdomen. I'll draw this out here so I can. That's called the abdomen, the thorax. And then we're going to come and make their head, which is a little bit smaller than the body. And if you need to come in there and erase. I do some erasing. I'm not a perfect drawer. There we go. And so once we get their head in, we're going to get the compound eyes, which the compound eyes are off, kind of off to the side. And then they also have three little other tiny eyes that are called simple eyes. They've got two antennas. And next we're going to do, they've got two sets of wings. The first set is called the four wings, which kind of comes in. And then the second one is called the hind wings. So this is the four wings. And this is the hind wings. Okay. We'll come out here and draw it again. Kind of make both sides equal. And then next, they have six legs. And so the first of them is right up front. You could kind of do little, I like to do their little. And then the other one, the other two are in the back. Kind of coming off of here. And then the other one is right back here. You can kind of give it a little definition. Kind of has a little shoulder pad looking legs right there. Oh, these right here actually are the pollen sacs. And then last, that stinger. Okay, so we have the abdomen, the thorax, the head, the compound eyes, the three eyes, the four wings, the hind wings, the legs, and the pollen sacs. Now, once we get to here, you can kind of get creative with it. I do like to make the lines on the back. Kind of come in there, make those lines. Then right here, you could kind of make, they have this movement on their backs. And then the wings get a little trickier, but they don't really have to be too precise, but you can kind of just make some wing movement in there. Same with this, just kind of put some wing action. I'm going to kind of go in there and fill everything up. And you could kind of, I'm going to make these real fun. I'll do this. We're going to draw out the wings. And then next we can start coloring it in, and I'm just going to maybe get, I'm going to do some purple eyes. There we go. And you know what? I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to make that stinger purple too, just for fun. And then next I've got, some hot pink. And I think I'm going to make my wings, some hot pink wings. And kind of color out there. Remember, these are called the four wings. These are called the hind wings. You know, I'm going to go ahead and just make my pollen sac legs pink right there, too. Okay. Now I'm going to bring in, I do want to do the yellow in here with the stripes. So I'm going to bring this yellow in here. And I'm gonna finish it up in here too and create this yellow. There we go. Now I'm gonna come in with the black. Actually, you know what? I'm going to circle this with some brown. They definitely are brown, although I'm not wanting to have a perfect looking day. Let's see. Oh. And then I'm going to come in with the black and really start making it pop, which is like what I call. If you had me in any of the classes, I always talk about making it pop. And this is how we make it pop. Kind of hit it with that black and outline everything. You know what? I'm going to make this into a piece B. Just because I can. And we got the peas. Because, you know, bees don't really want to sting you. All they want to do is go get the nectar, go cross-pollinate, and do their job. The only time that they are going to sting is if they feel threatened. And so we want to be nice to them and just kind of give them their space and let them do their thing. I don't know about you, I like fruits and vegetables, and I'm so glad that they go cross-pollinate so that our food can grow and the beautiful flowers. Oh, yeah. Almost done. And if you guys are still working on yours, you don't have to rush. You can continue to work on it. Maybe you could make a beehive in the background or some flowers, something. All right. Touch up some areas. All right, well, that's my piece B there for you. Put this back up. Also, I wanted to show you, I made this bee headpiece last year. I love it. I wear it out. I can teach this class. I'll adjust it again. Okay, well, that's it. Oh, one more thing. If you know where a bee hive or a bee swarm is, you can call 918-981-9000. bees, which is 2, 3, 3, 7. You might want to write this on your paper. 918-981 bees. They will come get the swarm or the beehive for free and take it to a farm where the bees can do their work. So, well, thanks for tuning in today, and thanks to AHA Tulsa, Tulsa Public Schools, and Rogers University for making this lesson possible. Let's find our own ways to keep Tulsa creative. Thank you so much.
Tess, and I am with the YMCA of Greater Tulsa, and I am so excited because from what I hear today is Movement Monday. So I know that you guys probably had a great weekend and you moved around a lot, and we were going to make sure that your Monday starts out great. So just before we get started, there's a couple of things that we need to go over. Number one, this is your workout, so make sure that you do what you can do. It's not a contest, it's not a race. Everyone's gonna go at their own pace. So just make sure that you're taking care of yourself and you're having fun. Number two is you're gonna need a soft spot and close to the middle of the workout where we're gonna lay down on the floor. So it may be a good idea to get a mat or somewhere soft in your area that you can lay down. And I
have a third rule. No judgment. We have a great time. You want to get silly and have a good time and being safe, there's no judgment there, so just make sure you have fun. This is your workout. I'm just here to help you do it. So why don't we go ahead and get started by warming up? I think that's a really great idea. We need to make sure we warm up our muscles, our legs, and our arms. So we're going to go ahead and get that started. Let's take it to a march. I'm so excited you guys are here with me today. Take some deep breaths. Go ahead, lean on that leg. Stretch the other leg. Other side. All right, back to that march. Just trying to get that heart ready. Stretch out those limbs. Let's go for our arms here. Cross it over the body. Other side. Good. Open up the chest. Out here. Good job. Put one foot in front, one foot back. Push those hips forward and stretch that leg. Other side. All right, let's do a quad stretch. Pick up that leg. Work on that balance while we're at it. Other side. All right, back to that march. Let's take it, reach it. Other side. Give me that march, right back. And reverse it. Nice job. Shake it out. I hope you're feeling nice and warm. I'm feeling warm. If you have a drink of water, you can go ahead and grab that water because we're getting ready to get a little bit intense. If you're watching this on maybe social media or YouTube or something like that, make sure you like and share the video because I know that you guys have somebody out there that's on your friends list or that's part of your family that really needs to get moving, especially on a Monday or maybe any day. So go ahead and share this video so that way they can move too. Sound good? All right, so now we're gonna move into the next part of our workout. It's called Tabata. So what that means is there's a certain amount of time that we're going to actually work and then we're going to rest. So the format will be work, rest, work, rest. I'll preview the movement for you and then I'll say, okay, ready, go, and then we'll go, and then we'll take a rest. So make sure that in that rest, you're still keeping your heart rate up, but we are going to take breaks. The movements are not too hard, but definitely are always modifiable if you need that done, okay? So let's move on and get into the work. I'm ready. You guys ready? Okay, I think I'm ready. All right, so we're gonna start with jumping jacks. You guys know how to do that, right? Modified version, just take a step out. All right, here we go. 3, 2, 1, let's go. All right, nice job. You feel that heart rate going up? 3, 2, 1, break. All right, keep moving those feet while we're on break. We've got heel touches, so we're gonna go down and up. Down and up. Here we go. 3, 2, 1, let's go. Try to keep that leg straight while you're touching the heel. 3, 2, 1, take a break. Still get that march going. All right, next we have lunges. Gotta go back. Let's go, join me. How you feeling out there? I hope you're feeling a lot stronger because you're getting stronger. 3, 2, 1, break. All right. Good job. Next, we have the arm circles. 3, 2, 1, let's go.
Exercises. We went forwards. Now we're going to go backwards. What do you think? I might even add a bonus exercise in there too. You never know with me. So grab that water really quick. Reset. Let's go. We're on round two. You guys have made it. We're halfway there. You guys got this. It's not a big deal. Let's go. We're going to start with ladder. Out, out, in, out, out, in. 3, 2, 1, let's go. Move those feet. Get on that imaginary ladder. 3, 2, 1, break. Woo! That was a lot of fun. All right, we've got squats. Here we go. 3, 2, 1, let's go. We're picking up the pace on these squats. One, nice. All right, we've got skaters. Let's go. Jump from one foot to the other. Great. Woo. Take those deep breaths. Arm circle. 3, 2, 1, let's go. Speed it up, speed it up. Reverse it. Stop. 3, 2, 1, break. Good job. We're gonna go for a side lunge this time. Let's go. Good job, push those hips back. warm. Good. Take that break. You can dance a little bit. I won't tell anybody. Heel touches. Honest with you, but it is Monday and you guys are working out with me, so I guess you get that as a little privilege. Go ahead and get a drink of water. It's time to move into phase three of our workout, which means we're going to get down on the floor, so make sure that you have that soft spot that you are ready to do. We're going to do some abdominal workouts. Plank. So let me show you the variations of the plank that you can do. There's a lot of different ways that you can do a plank. So the first way that might be the most common is where you have your hands placed on the floor and you also raise up your body to where you have your feet in the back, so your whole body is up off the floor. Okay, so that's the first variation that you can do. Second, you could go on your knees. So again, my body is still squared up, but I'm on my knees instead of my toes. The third variation would be to go down to the forearms. And again, you can raise the legs here, so you can have the whole body up, or you can keep the knees down. All of those variations will work that abdominal area. So just do whatever is best for you and whatever feels the most comfortable. Okay, so we're going to go into working our abs. We're going to be having an awesome beach body whenever we're done with all of this. You guys are doing great. Just stay with me. Lay it down. We're going to crunch up in the middle. 3, 2, 1, let's go. We're starting slow. Make sure that those shoulder blades come up off the ground. We're not going all the way up yet. Cross it over. So again, I'm going elbow to knee. Two more. Now we're going to go double time in the middle. Here we go. Up, up, up. Even go. Three, two, one, break. Nice job. Let's go to the side. Ready? Let's go. So again, you're crunching on that side of the body. Make sure you're breathing. 3, 2, 1, other side. Let's go. Twist. You can go double time
four singles. All right, we're gonna hold. Ready? Pick it up and hold. Breathe it out. Woo! Done! Oh my goodness, that was a killer! But I know you guys did fantastic with it. We should cool down because our time together is almost over, which is kind of, we have more time now.
Just kidding.
We are going to cool down in a minute, but we did really great with all of the ab workout. We did, it took a lot of workout. I'm gonna get you guys just a little bit more cardio going because I know you need it. I need it. We all need it. So go ahead and get that drink of water. I'm going to switch out the music really fast and then we will be ready to roll. All right, let's get some more cardio going. Take a step here. Pretend like you're maybe running a race. You're on the track. It's almost time. You're getting faster. Can you go faster? I know you guys at home are killing it. Here we go. All right, just to work you. Gonna work more of our arms. We didn't do too many arms. We're gonna pull here. Keep it going. You got it. All right, arms out. You can move your feet at the same time. Take it up. Arms here, up and down.
I know you guys aren't tired there. I know you still got something in ya. Keep going, keep going. This full cool down from beginning to end because we did do a lot of movements with our body. So I want to make sure that it's cool and that you can recover. Flip it back. Take it down. Point one foot, move the head. I'm so glad I got to work out with you guys today. It was a lot of fun. Movement Monday. Hashtag, that's good stuff. Take it down here and stretch one more time. Other leg. Cross it over, reach for that. Wait. Other side. Bring your feet together. Bring your feet together. Push it up. Open up. Take it back. Stretch that back. Take it down and hang. Roll it up slow. Lean in your head. Take a deep breath in. Let it out. Nice job. Hey, you guys did an excellent job today. Not bad for a Monday, I definitely think. I'm so glad that you guys tuned in. Make sure that you are liking and sharing the video because that's how we get more people moving every day of the week, no matter if it's Monday through Friday or even the weekends. So I'm so privileged and so thankful that I got to be here with you guys today. We got to do a little bit of moving. Make sure that you get some water, take a break, and have a great day because it's Monday. So thank you so much. We'll see you later.
Hi, everybody. Dusty from Discovery Lab in Tulsa, Oklahoma again, here for another experiment that you guys are going to be able to do at home with the parent or caregiver. Our experiment this time is going to deal with states of matter and chemistry. We're going to be making oobleck. If you'd like to make along with me, let's get our ingredients together. The first thing you're going to need is a big container to do your experiment in. The next thing you're going to want is some water. You're also going to need some pure starch. I'm going to be using cornstarch, but you can substitute for potato starch, tapioca starch, arrowroot powder. Any pure starch will work for this. However, you might have slightly different ratios. That's okay. You're also going to need some type of measuring device. You could even just use a regular old cup. Make sure you get a small cup if you do use a regular cup. A big cup is going to make it a little bit harder to play with the ratios. You'll also need a stirrer, a spatula, a spoon. You can even get a chopstick, whatever you guys like. This part is optional, but if you guys want to make it a little bit more fun and colorful, you guys can get some liquid watercolor, some tempera paint, some food dye, whatever you got to make our oobleck all kinds of crazy colors. And let's keep this for later. You need a disposable tub that has a good seal. Airtight, so you can play with your oobleck later. So while you guys are gathering supplies, let's talk a little bit about states of matter. Now, there are three basic states of matter whenever we're talking about science. The first one is solid. So you can see right here, I've got some ice. Now, my ice is a solid. If I take it out and I set it on the table, my ice stays in the shape of an ice cube. It doesn't change shape until it starts to warm up and melt and change state. My ice will melt into liquid water. Now, water is a fluid. Well, that means it's going to take the shape of whatever container it's in. Right now, it's in the shape of this container, kind of a cone shape. But if I pour it into this container, it's changed shape. It's now the shape of this container. If I was to pour it on the ground, it would take the shape of a puddle and fill the ground. So the difference between a solid and a liquid is that a solid has a set shape. It stays in one shape, whereas a liquid will take the shape of whatever container it's put in. Now, the last state requires a little bit of energy. So I've got my kettle right here. I've got some water in my kettle, and it's going to heat up the water, adding energy to it. Now, what's happening as I'm heating it up is all these little molecules of water are getting more and more energy. Imagine these balls are just little molecules of H2O. Whenever they were a solid, like ice, they were stuck together really, really tightly and couldn't move. As I added a little bit of energy, they're able to move and slide around each other as a liquid. Now, as I add even more energy, they start flying all over the place, bouncing around. This is going to cause my water to turn into a vapor or a gas. That's our third state of matter. Now, if you guys have ever had hot cocoa, hot tea, or if you ever seen like soup bubbling, you've seen steam rising. That is an example of the water molecules getting enough energy that they can convert into steam and rise up. Similar to fluids, gases want to fill the container they're in, but they don't have as much pull of gravity to pull them down into the container, so they'll expand and fill the entire room. They have enough energy they can bounce all around. For instance, this room is full of oxygen, a gas. The oxygen fills the room in every single corner. So now we can see that my water has started to boil. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to pull it out so you guys can see. If I pour it in to this one right here, you guys will see all that steam coming out of it. That steam coming out, that's all the water that's being converted to a vapor or a gas. So to reiterate, our three states of matter are solid, like ice, where the particles are really mashed together tightly, liquid, like water, where they've got a little bit of room to move around, and gas or vapor, where they have so much energy they can bounce all over the place. All right, hopefully you guys have grabbed your supplies and are ready to get started. Now, the fun thing about making our oobleck is that it's a ratio. What we mean by a ratio is that we don't have to have a specific measurement as long as they're relatively the same measurement. We're going to do what's called a 2-to-1 ratio. That means I'm going to put twice as much cornstarch as I am going to put liquid in. So if I'm using a quarter cup, I would put 2 scoops of cornstarch and one scoopful of water in it. If I'm using just a regular old cup without any measuring markings, same thing. I'm going to put two cupfuls to one. So that way the ratio stays the same. This way you can mix a very small amount or a huge amount as long as you keep your ratios the same. So let's get started. We're going to take our cornstarch and I'm going to measure up one cupful to start off with. Now, like I said, if you guys have got arrowroot, potato starch, any pure starch, this will work. However, be aware that yours might be slightly different than mine. That's okay. Because at the end, I'm going to do a little fine tuning with mine. So, I've got my cup measure. I'm going to pour the cornstarch in there, pouring it over the bowl so I try and get as little mess as possible. Let's see, is that an even? It's a little bit over a cup, but that's okay. I'll just have to play with it at the end. Now, if I was going to stop right there, I would put half as much water here. So I put in one cup of cornstarch, so I put in half a cup of water. But I want more ooble, so I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to do two cups of cornstarch. This one I'm not going to flip quite as much because that first one was really, really heavy, had a lot of extra. So I definitely want to try and keep as close to that 2-to-1 ratio as I can. All right, scrape off some of that extra. And so now I've got two cups of cornstarch. Now I'm going to put half as much water in there. So since I put two cups in here, I'm only going to put one cup of water. So I'm going to measure out my water. And if you guys are using any other cup, that's fine, so as long as you keep those ratios. And all I'm going to do is I'm going to stir as I pour. So I'm going to just, as I sprinkle this water in, mix it in. You want to keep it moving because this stuff can sometimes clump up if you let it sit too long. You definitely want to keep it always adding and moving. All right, so now I'm getting a pretty good mix right here. Oof, I'm messy. How many of you guys are messy? The good news is I get to clean all this up later. All right. So we can see that my water and my cornstarch are starting to combine. Now, if you remember, my cornstarch was a solid. I can pour cornstarch out and it would stay the shape of a big pile of cornstarch. My water was a liquid because it takes whatever shape of the vessel that it's in. Whenever I poured it into this cup, it was shaped like this cup. And it's in here, it's shaped like this vessel. Oh, yeah, that's pretty close right there. However, I do notice I have a few small dry chunks that haven't quite mixed in. So this is where I'm gonna have to fine tune it a little bit. Because I added a little bit over a cup with that first one, my ratio is slightly off. So I'm gonna add a spoonful at a time. Do it just a little bit at a time because it's always easier to add a little bit more than it is to take away. So just a splash until you get that right consistency. And let's see now. So what do you guys think? What are we making here? Let's investigate. Now, whenever we're investigating things with science, we want to use our senses. So one of our senses that we rely on a lot is our sense of sight. So I'm looking and I'm saying, this looks pretty gooey, it looks pretty liquidy, and I can see that it's all combined right here. Turning out pretty neat. Now, mine is looking pretty all right. So I'm gonna use some more senses. I'm gonna smell it. Does yours have kind of a funky smell? Nothing I'd wanna smell a lot of, but not bad. Next thing I want to do is I want to kind of listen, see if I hear anything. Is there any bubbling or fizzing? Is there some type of reaction going on? I don't really hear anything happening, so that just tells me that there probably isn't any type of reaction, bubbling, fizzing going on. Now, one sense we really never want to do unless we have really, really strict safety guidelines is our sense of taste. I don't just want to put things in my mouth because they might not be the best for me. So never put things in your mouth whenever you're using your senses to observe things unless it's under very strict circumstances. For instance, if you're experimenting with making bread or pasta or I don't know, some other things in the kitchen that are meant to be. This one right here, I'm not going to eat. Even though it's technically food items, it's not really anything I want to put in my mouth. So now it's time for the fun one. This is a touch. So I'm going to pull this guy out right here. I'm going to touch it. Ooh. What does it feel like to you guys? Feels slippery, soft, slimy. Now, one of the things I notice about this, even though it looks kind of liquid, whenever I do a few things to it, it acts kind of like a solid. It wants to stay in big chunks. So I can see that if I hold it up like this, it drips and it goos all up and it looks like a big, long, gooey liquid. But if I grab it and I pinch it, it acts a lot more like a solid. It's not gooey or liquidy. It keeps its shape for a little bit until then it turns back into a liquid and it starts to drip down, down, down. Now, you guys may be wondering, why is it acting like this? Well, this is a really cool example of something called a non-Newtonian fluid. So what that means is it doesn't behave the way you think it normally would. You guys might have heard that name, Newton, before. Isaac Newton was a very famous scientist. He devised a lot of laws of motion. He's the guy you probably remember with the apple and gravity and everything. But he came up with a way of determining how things should flow or move. There's a lot of things that don't actually go the way he thought they should. So those are called non-Newtonian. So this is an example of a shear thickening fluid. So in other words, the harder I try and stir it, the harder it gets. If I just stir it slowly and gently, my spoon goes through it pretty easily. The slower you go, the more easily it goes through. But as soon as you start trying to go hard, oh, it wants to chunk up and it wants to turn almost like a rock and impossible to move through. So this exhibits qualities of both a liquid and a solid, depending upon how much stress or pressure we're adding to this. Now, this is pretty fun, but I think I want to make it even cooler. Let's get out some of our colors. So I'm going to pick one color, and I'm going to give a couple of drops. If you want to measure a teaspoon, you can. If you just want to measure out drops, you can as well. The amount you add is going to change your colors. It's your experiment. So I'm just going to give it a good squirt right there with my blue. Now I'm going to watch and see what happens when I added that. I'm getting all sorts of fun. Look at those blue strings dropping down right there. Oh man. What does this remind you of? You guys ever seen anything look like this before? Ooh, that's really cool. I'm getting all these fun little kind of, almost it's tie-dye. Let's see if I can pick that up. Oh, yeah. Look at that dripping down. That's fun right there, isn't it? Now, you may be wondering, why does it behave this way? We talked about the three states of matter, and this one looks like a liquid, so it should act like a liquid. But the reason is because it's actually a liquid that has a solid suspended in it. My cornstarch is still solid, my water is still liquid. What's happening is those little particles of cornstarch are kind of floating in the water, and they're able to kind of move around each other, they can kind of change shape whenever I'm gentle with them. But whenever they get a lot of pressure, they get squeezed down, they don't move very well. So whenever I push down really hard, that makes those little molecules, instead of having a little space, they squeeze down tight. So that's what's happening, is they lock together whenever I try and push them together. So that's why it's acting that way. Ooh, what color did you guys do with yours? I don't know, this blue is pretty cool. I kind of want to mix it anymore. I love all the stripes and everything's happening. But I know as I mix it, it'll start to get together and I'll end up with this kind of fun light blue. And let's get another big, oh, that's so fun, how it strings out like that. So how many things have you guys seen in your house that behave like this? Believe it or not, there's actually a lot of things that are considered non-Newtonian fluids. And I'll bet you use a couple of them on a daily basis. How many of you guys have ever had syrup or honey? Yeah, whenever you guys try and get it out, it feels really thick and really hard to get out. But if you give it a good squeeze, it comes right out. If you just hold it upside down, it really wants to stick in the bottle. Kind of like ketchup. Or shampoo. Whenever you squeeze it out, it looks like a liquid, but then it holds its shape like a solid. Lotion's another good example of that, too. It has properties of both a solid and a liquid, depending upon how much pressure or stress it's under. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to add another color so we can see how it kind of mixes together. What do you guys think? Should we do green, yellow, or red? I think we're going to do red because I think that's going to have a really cool extra little bit right here. So what do you think is going to happen whenever I mix together my red and my blue? Am I going to get cool red, white, and blue stripes? Am I going to get like green? Or am I going to get yellow? Or am I going to get purple? What do you guys think? Well, that's the fun thing about science. Whenever we have an idea, a guess, or a hypothesis would be the science term for a really good guess, we get to test it. That's what experiments are. They're testing our best guesses. What are some guesses or ideas you guys have about this experiment? Could you do that at home, you think? I bet you could. So if you guys have any ideas, thoughts about ways you could experiment with this, that's awesome. Oh, there was a big chunk right there. So if I get this big chunk right here, you guys can see that if I kind of wad them up and I roll into a big ball. It'll stay the shape of a ball as long as I keep moving and rolling. It actually starts to crumble apart. And then as soon as I stop rolling it, oh, it goes right back to a liquid. Now it's turned purple. So I was telling you guys about a few other things you have in your house that are non-Newtonian substances. Now, our word for how things kind of ooze or flow or move is called viscosity. If something's very thick, very viscous, it doesn't want to go out very easily. If you've ever tried to pour out like molasses or syrup, you know it's very thick and gooey. It doesn't really want to come out very easily. But something like milk or orange juice comes right out real easily. So I have a really fun way to show that to you. I've got these tubes right here, and they've got balls inside of them. Now, I'm going to flip them over, and we're going to see which one the ball goes down the fastest. Which one do you think? So let's see. Which one do you think the ball's going down the fastest? I've got red, green, gray, blue, and black tops. You can see they're all pretty close to the same color. This one's a little bit more yellow, but the rest of them are pretty clear. All right, you ready? 3, 2, 1. So I flip them over, you guys can see those balls start sliding down. And this one's already at the bottom. This one just got to the bottom. This one got to the bottom. This one's almost the bottom. You can see this middle one, this gray one, is taking forever. This is a very thick or a very viscous liquid. It takes a lot of pressure to move it out of the way. This one was very thin. It was not very viscous at all. So the viscosity or the thickness of things can change depending upon the pressures we put it on. How many of you guys have ever tried to get toothpaste out? Sometimes it takes a lot of pressure to squeeze it out, and it comes out looking a lot like liquid. But when it sits on your toothbrush, it stays the same shape. Ketchup's a pretty fun example. If you guys have ever had to try and get ketchup out of a bottle, you know sometimes it gets really, really stuck in there, like it's solid. But if you give it a couple good whacks or a good shake, it comes out a lot more easily. Ketchup is the opposite of my ooblet. Ketchup actually gets thinner the more pressure or stress I put it under, instead of getting thicker. So to show you, I'm going to take this guy right here, and I'm going to squeeze out some ketchup in here. So you guys can see, my ketchup stays in there really solid. It doesn't want to move around. It doesn't behave like a liquid. But whenever I open this up and squeeze it with the pressure, you can see it drops out like a liquid. So as I squeeze or add pressure to it, it turns more liquid. But if I stop adding pressure, it turns more solid. The opposite of this guy. And there's a little bit of that. So now, you can see it's staying the same shape. It's kind of mounded up. It's not moving very much. But if I add some force or some pressure to it, some shear strength, you can see it behaves a lot more like a liquid. So if I'm spinning this guy around, it's acting like a liquid as soon as I stop. It'll go back to being a solid, all congealed there together. So this is another example of a non-Newtonian substance. What are some things that you guys can do at home to test if you have non-Newtonian substances? Remember, there's a lot of different ones. Some of them will change with temperature. Some of them will change with time. Some of them will change with force. They might get thicker, more viscous, or thinner, less viscous with time. So let's go back to my Google and take a look at this guy. So yeah. He's just nice and smooth as I draw my spoon through here, nice and slowly. It wants to just kind of follow it. I try to poke it. I just try to gently put my spoon in, go to the bottom. But if I try and stab it harder, it's like a crack wall. Or if I get it to the
bottom, and I slowly pull it out. You can see it acts a lot more like a loop. But what happens if I'm trying to pull it out really, really fast? Oh, did you see that? It stuck so hard in my spoon, I actually lifted my bowl off the table because it was so solid and stuck on there. Oh, I should probably stop. That's glass, and I don't want to clean up a lot of glass. But this is so fun to play with because it's so simple to make. Now, if you like me, you're a little messy, and you got colored hands, that's okay. Because as it dries, it turns light up into cornstarch. All you need to do is try to dust your hands off or get a dry towel and just wipe them off. As you get more water on it, it's going to turn back into this blue-black. It's going to be sticky. It's a lot easier to wipe off when it's dry than whenever it's wet. So that's my tip for you guys. Try and get it cleaned up when it's dry, not wet. Also, if you got it in your clothes and anywhere else, you can just take a butter knife, scrape it off, vacuum up the dust, so it's really easy to clean up. Now, I talked about keeping this for later, and that's okay if you have some fruit for later, have it out. But whenever you're disposing of it, never put it down the sink. You see how hard this is? If you put this down your sink, it would plug it up really badly. Always dispose of this in the trash can. You need to throw it away in the garbage. Or you could put it into a compost bin if you'd like, but never the sink. Because, like I said, you don't want that stuck in your pipe. Mom and Dad would not be happy with you. Plumber wouldn't be happy with you. I don't think you'd be happy with you if you plug that box up. All right. Now, you can see, I've got this beautiful curve. Now, I'm going to do something. I'm just going to roll it around, and you guys can see it flows so much like water. It just wants to kind of curl around it. But I'm trying to shake it upside down. It doesn't come out. That's because I'm still adding force to it. Whenever I shake it, I'm still adding that force to it. So no matter how you add that force, stirring, picking it up, dropping it, whatever, it's going to behave differently. Scrape this down so you can see it again. Something else that's fun is this guy has different dentins. What that means is that it's got different grades. So if I add a little bit more water, what happens is this guy would get even thinner. And be elastic. How many of you guys have ever been swimming and you're able to float really easily? Cool. That's because you are less dense or lighter than the water. So now if I take a wooden ball and a metal ball, which one do you think is more dense? The wooden ball or the metal ball? The metal ball is more dense. It's heavier. The parts that make it up are crushing it so tightly. So if I drop my wind ball in here, it starts to sink down a little bit slowly. I drop this guy here. Oh, he gets with such force, and he sinks all the way to the bottom. He's so dense that he wants to roll all the way to the very bottom. He can completely cover it up. I'm trying to pull him out. Oh, it's stuck in there really good. Now, what color did you guys turn? That sounds pretty cool. Well, let's go over the things that we talked about in our experiment today. So the first thing we talked about is we talked about states of matter. Remember, our three basic states of matter are solid, like ice or rock. Liquid would be something like milk or water. Gas would be things like oxygen or water vapor, air. As we get hotter, we tend to go from solid to liquid, to gas, just like how my ice cubes melted as they got hotter and hotter and hotter. They turned from solid to liquid, and I heated them up all the way. They turned to gas. Whenever we combine our water and our cornstarch, we use a ratio. That means that it's relative to the other. It's a 2-to-1. As long as you use twice as much cornstarch as you do water, it'll be good. Or, put it in inversely, use half as much water and you do cornstarch. It's still the same ratio. Whenever these are combined, they create booglet, which is a non-Newtonian substance. That means it doesn't behave the way that I just never thought it would. This is an example of a shear thickening substance. That means that as I move it more, it gets harder and thicker. But as I kind of let it sit for a while and I don't add any energy to it, it gets thinner and less viscous. It wants to just kind of flow out like a liquid. Remember our word viscous. Viscous means thick and resistant, hard to flow. What's the thing, one thing in your house you think is the most viscous or the hardest to pour out? I wonder if you could do a test to find out what things are the thickest or the most viscous. Last but not least, we discussed density. Whatever things are packed together tightly, they're very dense and heavy. Why do they have space in between them? They're very light. Well, I hope you guys have had a lot of fun playing with me and making some oobleck. Remember to clean up your mess, and if you're getting rid of it, throw it in the garbage, not the sink. This will keep for a while in an airproof bag, so you can keep it and play with it more. Just make sure that you try and keep the messes to a minimum. All right, well, I think that's going to do it for us here at Discovery Lab. I've been Mr. Dusty, and thanks so much for hanging out with us, guys.
Guys, we're on. Hi, everybody. My name is Mr. Simon,
with Hot Toast Music Company.
And I am Isaac, and this is Ezra.
Are you Ezra?
Yeah, and here's Isaac, and my dad,
Mr. Simon.
And here's my dad, Mr. Simon. Then my mom, Petra. And here's my brother, Isaac.
Yeah, Mama's right over there.
And here's me, Ezra.
Yeah, so we got our instruments, and today we're going to be singing you songs. About what? What are we going to be singing to them about? Anybody remember?
Our big emotions.
Our big emotions.
Do you guys have big emotions?
Yeah.
Yeah, we do. We have big emotions here, and we call it feeling the feels. And today, all of our songs and what we're going to talk about, it's all about finding ways to make room for our emotions to help us understand what they are, and we don't want to talk on top of each other. To help us understand what they are and what we can do with them. Like, do you guys ever feel sad?
Yeah.
Does anybody ever feel happy here?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. We feel a lot of things. Oh, yeah. So our first song is called I Like Singing. Here's how it goes. I hope you'll sing along.
I like singing all my favorite songs. I like singing, especially when you sing along.
Here we go.
Do, do, do.
Sing it with me.
Do, 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 do. And getting out my moves.
As you got any moves to get out today?
I like dancing, especially with you. Singing do do do. I'm singing do 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 do.
Is going out to my drummer right here, this guy.
I like drumming and making lots of beats. Oh, I like drumming, especially with my feet. Singing do do do. Singing do do do.
Let me hear those feet beats.
I like listening for music everywhere, and I like making my own music to share.
Last time. Wow, that was really great. I loved hearing all of your voices. It's so magical when we all sing together, and it reminds us that we're all in this together. None of us is really alone. We have each other, and there's so many things that we share in common. But you know what? The things we have in common are not the only things that are important. In fact, there are a lot of ways we're different from each other, aren't there? Can you guys think of any ways that we are different from each other?
I like being a daddy pig, and I want my pig, and I play now I have pig, and I play now on my pig.
Like our faces look different?
Yeah.
Hang on, let's see here.
Yeah, like I have pig do like that, my pig do like this. And I think so like that.
Here, let's put our noses together. Let's see. Do our noses look the same?
That is bigger than ours.
What? It is pretty big. Look, watch. Look how big my nose is. And I've got this big beard on my face.
Your beard? They do have beard.
Do you have a beard? Maybe you do. I don't know. But there are so many ways. And look, at are our clothes the same?
No, because I have clothes. yellow and black.
Yellow and black, and I have the red. Izzy, look at, he's got blue. There are so many things that make us different from each other. And do you know what, guys?
And Daddy has the dark and blue.
What about Adam?
And then our hair with the black.
Yeah, there are different kinds of hair. Even you guys are brothers, and look at how different your hair is. Izzy has some curls. Your hair is straight, and my hair is messy. Do you know what, you guys? The ways we're different are so important. They made our
hair like a ponytail.
Hers isn't a ponytail. The ways we're different, they make our world interesting. And they make this a really exciting place to live.
And that.
Here's what I want you guys to do. We're looking in the screen right now and we can see our faces. But if you have a mirror in your house, go find it. Or see if you can borrow your parents' phone and turn it around so you're looking at yourself, kind of like a selfie. Our next song is called the Mirror Song. And for this one, you're going to need to sing to you. Here's how it goes. Who's that over there looking at me? The longer I look, the more they stare. They change my expression, they change theirs. I know I've seen that person somewhere. When I look in the mirror, I see a reflection of me. My nose, my ears, my eyes, they fit perfect on a face like mine. When I look in the mirror, I see myself looking back at me. My skin, my smile, my teeth, I sure do like being me. I sure like being me. All right. Who's that over there looking my way? They're copying every single face I make. Can you guys make some funny faces? When I smile when they sway. It's like they're copying every single move I make. Well, when I look in the mirror, I see a reflection of me. My nose, my ears, my eyes, they fit perfect on a face like mine. When I look in the mirror, I see a reflection of me. My nose, my smile, my teeth, I sure do like being me. I sure like to be me. Now listen up. You and I, we're not the same, but that's a good thing, because there's a lot to gain from diversity. It's true, we might have a lot in common, but the ways we're different are also important, because there's beauty in you and you and you and me. When I look in the mirror, I find a person that I like. My skin, my smile, my teeth, I sure do like being me. One more time, ready? Sing it soft to them. When I look in the mirror, I know I'm looking at wonderful. From the tip of my toes to the top of my head, I sure do like to be myself. Oh man, wasn't that fun? It's so exciting to really think about how special you are. And if you celebrated a birthday lately, And that's like the day we all celebrate the wonder of what it means to be you. So hey boys, I've got a question for you for this next song. And you guys, I want to let you know, if you get bored, or if you're having a hard time being on the TV, that's totally okay. You can totally go and just take a break, take some breaths, and come back when you want, okay? Yep, no one's making you. So take as many breaks as you guys need, all right? Yeah, you guys need to take a break? Go ahead.
Bye.
They might be
bye.
Fine. See you soon.
Bye.
I love doing music with them so much. In fact, all this music I'm sharing with you, I made with them. You know, it's really a cool thing to be a kid, because you're getting to experience so much about the world for the first time. But there's a lot that can be confusing too. And it takes time to understand things, and you have to ask a lot of questions, not just about yourself, but about the world you're in. That way you can learn more about it. You know, we're in a time right now when there are so many big changes happening. I don't know about you, but this has not been easy to stay home all the time and be away from friends and family. It's been really tough sometimes. But for us, I'd like to kind of give you some advice about what we've been doing. We've been doing a lot of singing. We've come up with songs to express the way we feel. And on days that are hard and days that are happy, we like to fill them up with our favorite songs. So we made a song actually just a couple days ago, and it's all about change. Did you know that you were made for change? From the time you were born, you've been changing. You've been getting bigger. Your powerful brain's been growing. There was a time when you couldn't even make words. And look at you now. You're talking and you're thinking and coming up with ideas and solving problems. Who knows what you could become in the future? You might even be a superhero someday that helps to change the world. The thing about change is, it can be really exciting, but sometimes it can be hard too. And sometimes it's like it's hiding around the corner. We don't really see it coming. Kind of like the changes that have happened now. None of us expected to be out of school right now, did we? But you know what? Even in the times that are hard, if you feel sad or scared, you can always remember that you were made for this. You've got this. You're going to make it through. And everything about you was built to be able to change. A big word for this is adapt. Animals do this out in nature too. When times get hard and they're living in maybe habitats that don't have the best conditions, they change. One place I know this happens is way down at the bottom of the ocean in the midnight zone. Have you heard of this place? There's no sunlight and there's very little food. Can you imagine living in a place like that? You would think nothing could live down there, but actually there are some amazing creatures that have changed in order to make that place their home. Like the cookie cutter shark that has a green glow-in-the-dark belly, or the anglerfish that makes its own light and hangs it in front of itself to catch other fish. Isn't that wild? I'm going to share a song with you now. This song is called Change, and here's how it goes. Sometimes change can be exciting. Sometimes change is just hard. Some surprises can lead to ice cream, but some boo-boos can leave scars. Sometimes you know that change is coming. Sometimes it's hiding in the dark. Sometimes a change feel like an ending. Other kinds are just the start. Oh, change can happen just like that. One day you're a kitten and the next you're a cat. Change can be slow and change can be fast. One day you're an egg
and the next you'll have. Keep singing your way. Singing your way through the change. Singing your way. Singing your way. And anytime you feel afraid, remember that you were made for change. Sometimes change can be confusing. Sometimes a change feels like losing. There are changes, yours for the choosing, and there is change you can't refuse. Oh, change could happen just like that. One minute you're a kitten, and the next you're a cat. Change can be slow, the change can be fast. One day you're an egg, and the next you're a hatch. Keep singing your way. Keep singing your way. Singing your way. Keep singing your way. And anytime you feel afraid, remember that you were made for change. Remember that you were made for change. You got this, man. One more time, ready? Keep singing your way, singing your way through the change. Sing your way. Sing away, and any time you feel afraid, remember that you were made to change. You were literally made for this. Oh, that actually felt good. I'm going to do it again. Have you been breathing today? It sounds like a really funny question, doesn't it? I mean, we kind of have to breathe to be able to live. But actually, did you know a lot of times our bodies forget to breathe? Especially if you're feeling some big emotions. I don't know what you're feeling like today, but I've been having a pretty good day. And still, when I took that big breath, I realized I wasn't getting enough air in my body until right then. Our bodies were made to take in a lot of air. And that oxygen that your body keeps when you breathe in, that's what makes your brain work. And that's what keeps your body feeling calm and peaceful. So if you have a day when you're having trouble thinking about how to solve a problem, or you're having trouble calming yourself, one of the most important things you can do is take big, giant breaths. For us in our house, we call these breaths ocean breaths. Kind of like the way the ocean will roll up onto the shore and even crash on the shore. And then it goes right back out. Out to the sea and builds up a whole bunch of force and then crashes again. That's how we like to breathe in our house. We even have a song about it. It's called Breathe In and Breathe Out. And if you joined us last time during our time here on RSU TV, we started to do this song. I think it's how we ended our time together. But I wanted to play it again for you today because something so special is happening this week. We made a video, a music video with kids all over our city here in Tulsa, Oklahoma, that came together and practiced different ways that we can remind our bodies to take the breaths they need to be able to feel calm and focus. It's called Breathe In and Breathe Out, and you're going to be able to find it on the internet tomorrow. So you get a little sneak peek today. I'm going to show you the song. This is called Breathe In and Breathe Out, and here's how it goes. Breathe out and breathe in. Let's all take another ocean breath, just like the waves crash on the beach and roll back out to the sea. That's the sound that it makes when we breathe. Breathe in and breathe out. Stretch out your arms and try to touch the clouds. And when you take a breath in deep, you feel peace. Feel you from your head to your feet. Here we go, let's all breathe in. Now breathe out, breathe in, and breathe it out. Breathe out, now breathe in. Let's all pretend that we are the wind and we can blow the leaves on a tree or send a gentle breeze to a neighbor that needs to feel peace. Breathe in and breathe out. If you're feeling sad, you don't have to pout, just let me air into your lungs and think of someone you love, and the calmness will fill you back up. Let's take those breaths and see if you can feel the calmness fill you up as I play. Breathe in. Now breathe it out. Breathe in and breathe it out. Man, it's so wonderful when we give our body what it needs to be at its best. And air is one of those things. Another one is food. I don't know about you, but I'm starting to feel hungry. I think I'm going to get some lunch right after this. Paying attention to our bodies is so important. But I'll tell you what else is important. Understanding what's happening in our bodies. And one really important way to do this is by using our powerful words to describe what's happening in our bodies. So I have a song all about what our emotions are called. And it's called Whining Doesn't Work. And I'm going to leave you with this song today. This is one we've used a lot in our house. Sometimes when you don't know what's going on in your body, our first tendency is to throw a giant fit and to just go, you just start throwing this giant fit and whining because you don't know what's happening. But if you can give a name to your emotions, you begin to know what they are. And that helps you know what to do with them and to tell other people what's happening, so that they can help too. This is called Whining Doesn't Work. Whining doesn't work. I know because I've tried it. Whining only hurts everybody's ears. So don't bother throwing a fit. Oh, I'll tell you what works better. Just take a great big breath and say the way you feel. That if you feel emotions and you want them to be heard, the best way to share your feelings is
Sometimes I feel glad. Sometimes I feel grumpy. Sometimes I feel sad. Sometimes I feel silly. Sometimes I get shy. Sometimes I feel excited. Sometimes I feel surprised. Crying is okay. Tears wash away sadness, but crying's not the same as whining for what you want. Whining's not the only way to get someone's attention. If you want someone's attention, you may have to listen first. So if you feel emotions and you want them to be heard, the best way to share your feelings is to turn them into,
yeah,
words. Sometimes I feel energetic. Sometimes I feel overwhelmed. Sometimes I like to play with others. Sometimes I need time by myself. Sometimes I feel frustrated. And sometimes I feel scared. Sometimes I feel very, 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 very weird. Sometimes I get disappointed. Sometimes I feel content. Sometimes I can't make up my mind. But sometimes I'm confident. Oh, sometimes I feel like moving. Sometimes I just feel calm. Sometimes I like it quiet. Sometimes I wanna sing a song. So if you feel emotions and you want them to be heard, the best way to share your feelings is to turn them into words.
Well, I hope I've given you some ideas for how to describe the things you might be feeling today. And I just heard Isaac say, see you later. They're in the other room, and so they're signing off along with me, but they also, they needed some space to go and play. Listen to your body today. What does it need? Do you need to take space? Are you overwhelmed? Then take some space. Go sit outside and listen to the birds sing, or take a little walk in your backyard or through your neighborhood and pick up some objects that make you feel peaceful, like a stick or maybe a rock, a peace rock. Or just sit and take some breaths and listen to your favorite songs. I'm so happy you all joined me today, and I hope you'll stay in touch with us at Hot Toast Music Company. Don't forget, we're putting out a brand new video with the Breathe In, Breathe Out song that you can listen to starting tomorrow. So, until I see you again, this has been so wonderful, and I hope you all have a great day. I'll think of each of you in my heart until I see you again. Bye-bye. I'm going to start picking up my guitar.